My name is Dr. Payal Ghosh. Today I am going to discuss motivation and emotion. Before discussing what is motivation or what is emotion, let me explain you a few instances. Suppose a girl who is from a small town works very hard so that she can crack entrance exam of engineering colleges. Or suppose a boy who saves money from his scholarship so that he can buy gifts for his mother. So here in both cases, the person is behaving in a particular way, or the person is doing something because the person wants to achieve a goal. In case of the girl, the goal is to achieve crack the entrance exam of engineering college. So she is working very hard. In case of the boy, boy is saving money so that he can buy gift for his mother. So here we can say motivation means when there is a goal and we behave in a particular way to achieve that goal. So it is motivation. Motivation helps us to predict our behavior. Now again, if you use these instances, suppose that the girl failed to crack entrance exam despite her hard work. So how she is going to feel? She is going to feel sad, she is going to feel frustrated. Or suppose the boy saves money to buy a gift, but the money gets stolen. Here, how is going to feel? He is going to feel sad, he is going to feel angry. So here we discuss different emotion. So in this chapter, first we'll discuss motivation, and the second part we'll discuss different emotion. The first topic is motivation. Under motivation, the first topic that I am going to discuss is nature of motivation. So already I have discussed motivation means when there is a particular goal and we want to achieve the goal. So we behave in a particular way to achieve that goal. That is motivation. So motivation, that is something that determine our behavior. Instinct, drive, need, goal, incentives, which we use under the broad concept of motivation. To explain motivation, we'll discuss the motivational cycle. Motivational cycle, the first thing is there is a need. Need means lack of something or deficit of something. Because of that deficit or because of that need, there is a drive. Drive leads to a state of arousal or tension. Because I need something, I have a tension or arousal that I need that thing. And that tension and arousal will help me to behave in a particular way that leads to goal-directed behavior. Goal-directed behavior means we behave in a particular way so that we can fulfill that need. Then come, if after behaving in a particular way, help us to achieve the goal, help us to fulfill the need, then come the achievement. After achievement, once I achieved whatever I want to achieve, then I read to, there will be reduction of the arousal or drive. Once the drive or reduction tension is reduced, then in the next need will emerge. In this way, the cycle will go on. So let me explain this cycle with an example. Suppose I want to crack an exam. That is my goal, my objective is to crack the exam, entrance exam, so that I can get admission in a good college. So that particular need creates some tension and creates some drive, some tension and arousal within us. So for that, I will behave in a particular way that will help me to crack the entrance exam. So what I will do, I will get admission in a good institution that will guide me how to study, how to prepare for the entrance exam. Then I will follow all the instructions given by the institutions. I will work hard. I will give my effort so that I can achieve my goal. So after that, after all that hard works and everything, when I am able to crack entrance exam of one college and I am able to get admission in a college, that will be the achievement part. And once I have achieved my goal, then my tension, my arousal will reduce. Then next need will arise. Next need is that once I have get admitted in a college, then now I have to perform. I have to score good marks in my first year examination. So the next need is here. That will again lead to drive and arousal, and the cycle will go on like this way. Next, we'll discuss different types of motives. So, we can divide motives into two categories, biological motives and psychosocial motives. Biological motives are also known as physiological motives. Our physiological mechanisms, they play important role in these biological motives. Physiological mechanism means hormones, endocrine glands, neurotransmitters, brain, nervous system. This they actually play important role in developing this and creating these motives. Biological motives are based on the concept of instinct. Instinct means something which is innate, which is inborn, which we do not learn. Rather, they are present from the birth within us. Some common human instincts are curiosity, repulsion, reproduction, paternal care. So, curiosity is an instinct. Curiosity means desire to know different things, to gain experience. So, curiosity is an instinctual thing, something which is there within us. And because we are curious, so we explore the environment, we want to know the environment. Reproduction is an instinctual behavior. Reproduction, the goal of reproduction is to create more members from our species, from our species, so that our species doesn't get extinct from the environment. So it is another motive of difference of all the species to reproduce new members. Paternal care, care for other, care for children. This is also an instinctual thing that is there within us, that we don't learn, rather that is present from within us from the beginning. So instinct are the other tendencies, internal tendencies, and instinct direct our behavior, predict our behavior. Next, we'll discuss some biological motives. The biological motive that we'll discuss are hunger, thirst, sex. The first biological motive is hunger. Hunger, now how we feel hungry? What is the physiological changes in body that cause hunger? So, when our stomach is empty, there is a constriction in the stomach, and this constriction sends signal to us that we are hungry. Or if the glucose level in the blood is low, it again sends signal to us that we are hungry. If the protein and fat which is stored in our body is low, then it again sets signal to us that we are hungry. Liver, when body needs food, then liver sets signal to the brain and we feel hungry. Also, the aroma, the taste, the way the food is, the appearance of the food also lead to the feeling of hunger. So, agar koi khane ka smell achcha hai, koi khane dikhne mein achcha hai, agar mujhe hum log ko pata hai, uska taste achcha hai, toh usse bhi hum log ko hunger ka feeling hota hai. So, aisa nahi hai ki koi ek factor ke liye responsible hai hunger ke liye. Rather, these factors are in combination, they develop the feeling of hunger within us. So now we'll discuss the physiological mechanism of hunger. So if there is any changes in the metabolic function in the liver sends signal to the hypothalamus. Hypothalamus can send signal to either lateral hypothalamus or to the ventromedial hypothalamus. The lateral hypothalamus or LH is an excitatory area. It means it increases the feeling of hunger. And ventromedial hypothalamus is the hunger controlling area. It means it controls the hunger behavior. So suppose there is a need for food, so there is some changes in the metabolic function of the liver. The liver will send signal to the hypothalamus that body needs food, and hypothalamus will send signal to the lateral hypothalamus that we need food, and in that case we'll feel this portion is stimulated and we'll feel hungry. But if we have enough food in our body and we don't need any food, then the liver again sends signal to the hypothalamus. Hypothalamus will send signal to the ventromedial hypothalamus that our body reached the satiety level, we don't need food anymore. So it will control the hunger behavior. So we will not feel hungry anymore. So this is a physiological mechanism of hunger. The next biological motive that I will discuss is thirst. Thirst, how we feel thirsty? Or what triggers thirst in our body? First, if the cells lose water, and second, if the there is a reduction of blood volume in the body. In both cases, we feel thirsty. So now we'll discuss the physiological mechanism of thirst. This is called cellular dehydration theory. Suppose there is a सेलुलर डिहाइड्रेशन थ्योरी मीन्स इफ द सेल इज डिहाइड्रेटेड, इफ देर इज अ लॉस ऑफ वाटर इन द सेल और द सेल रिक्वायर वाटर, दे सेंड सिग्नल टू द ऑस्मो रिसेप्टर्स. दिस ऑस्मो रिसेप्टर्स आर लोकेटेड एट एंटीरियर हाइपोथैलेमस. दिस ऑस्मो रिसेप्टर जनरेट सम नर्व सिग्नल्स एंड दिस सिग्नल्स एक्चुअली क्रिएट ट्रिगर द फीलिंग ऑफ थर्स्ट एंड वी देन नीड टू ड्रिंक द वाटर. Now the next question is, what is the physiological mechanism which helps us to know that we need to stop drinking water? So according to researcher, the mechanism which I explained in the previous slide that helps us to know how when we need water, it's actually responsible for stopping the intake of water. Also, there is another theory which say that when there is a stomach is when we don't need water, stomach sends signal to the brain. And we know that we need to stop drinking water. Now the next motive that biological motive that I will discuss is sex. Sex is a biological motive, but sex is different from other biological motive, that is hunger and thirst. So let us discuss the difference. Sexual activity is not necessary for survival. Like hunger and thirst, they are necessary for survival. Without food, without water, we cannot survive. We'll die. But sexual activity is not like that. Second, hunger and thirst, they are required to maintain body balance, to homeostasis. Whenever we are hungry, whenever there is a lack of food in our body, or whenever we are thirst, whenever these cells are dehydrated, that actually disturb our balance, body balance, or homeostasis. To maintain that, restore that equilibrium, so we eat food or drink water. But sexual activity, the goal is not to maintain the body balance. It is not objective of the sexual activity. Third, hunger and thirst, they are present from birth and throughout our life. But sexual drives develops with age. Once person reach puberty, once person becomes sexually mature, develops sexually mature, they develop sexual drive. So these are the difference between sex and other primary motives. Now we'll discuss physiology of sexual drive. So sexual urges are controlled by hormones known as sex hormones. The sex hormones are secreted by gonads. In case of male, testes secrete male sex hormones, and in case of females, ovaries secrete female sex hormones. Other endocrine glands like adrenal pituitary glands also influence sexual drive. Sexual drive is also influenced in case of human, it is also influenced by external stimulus and culture. Culture and society. So our cultural learning, our society's belief determine our sexual expression. Society, which is very conservative, their people express their sexual behavior in a particular way. But society which is very liberal, their people express their sexual drive in completely different way. So society, cultural factors and cultural learning are very important in determining how people are going to express their sexual drive. So far we have discussed the biological motives which are innate, like hunger, thirst and sex. So now we'll discuss psychosocial motives. Psychosocial motives are learned or acquired. We acquire these motives through our interaction in our social environment. Our family, our neighbors, our friends, our relatives, they play important role in developing these motives. Let me give you one example. Suppose someone has high motivation for achievement. So here the motivation the person develops, here maybe his family play very important role in here, because in family maybe it is very family members, they give very importance to the achievement, to the personal achievement. Cultural factors are very important in developing psychosocial motives, like individualistic culture where individual achievement is more important, the people develop psychosocial motives of achievement, most likely to develop psychosocial motive of achievement. Or culture like collectivist culture where interpersonal relationships are important, their people mostly develop or more likely to develop need for affiliation. Now we'll discuss different kind of psychosocial motive. The first motive is need for affiliation. Need for affiliation means desire to be physically and psychologically close to other individual, desire to be loved, to have friendship, to develop friendship, to have company of other people. This is called need for affiliation. So people with high need for affiliation, they are ready to sacrifice their own personal happiness, their own personal interest or achievement to have support and love for other member of the society, so to have support and love of the family. So we can see that many people are there who are ready to sacrifice their own happiness so that they can get support and love from their family. So these people have high need for affiliation. Second, we'll discuss need for power. Need for power means when person want to control the behavior and emotion of other people. These people with need, high need for power, they have desire to influence, to control, control others' behavior and to improve their own reputation in front of others. Now, how people express their power motive? McClellan in 1975 proposed that there are four ways by which people express their power motive. First, people try to be powerful or think, try to develop a feeling of power by attaching themselves with some popular figure. So suppose कोई बहुत पॉपुलर है, किसी का बहुत मतलब सोसाइटी में बहुत इफेक्ट है, तो हम लोग क्या करते हैं उसके साथ हम लोगों का क्या सिमिलरिटी है वो दिखते हैं, एंड वी फाइंड दैट वी हैव सम सिमिलरिटी बाय अटैचिंग देमसेल्फ विद अ पॉपुलर फिगर. और हम लोग कैसे बोलते हैं कि हमको उसको उसके साथ मेरा पर्सनल कनेक्शन है, कोई कोई है जो बहुत पॉपुलर है उसके साथ मेरा पर्सनल कनेक्शन है, उसको मैं पर्सनली जानती हूँ. ऐसे हम लोग अपना जो पावर है, अपना जो फीलिंग ऑफ पावर है, उसको हम लोग बढ़ाते हैं. सेकेंड, द सोर्स कैन बी फ्रॉम विद इन अस. So how we are going to feel powerful when we think that when we have the ability to control our urges, control our impulses, when we are physically fit. So we do exercise, yoga, and so that we can be physically fit, we can have control on our own impulses, emotions and urges, and we feel powerful. So here the source is internal. Then people feel powerful by thinking that how much impact I have on other person. So अगर मेरा इफेक्ट मेरा बहुत इफेक्ट होगा दूसरे के बिहेवियर में, दूसरे मेरे प्रेजेंस का अगर दूसरे के बिहेवियर में कुछ इफेक्ट होगा और मैं कुछ करती हूँ जिसके इफेक्ट सोसाइटी में होगा, देन वी ऑल्सो फील पावरफुल. फोर्थ, वी बिकम पार्ट ऑफ अ ऑर्गेनाइजेशन विच इज अ पावरफुल ऑर्गेनाइजेशन, एंड एज अ मेंबर ऑफ दैट ऑर्गेनाइजेशन ऑल्सो आई फील दैट आई हैव पावर टू इन्फ्लुएंस अदर पीपल. लाइक सपोज मैंने कुछ पोलिटिकल पार्टी ज्वाइन कर लिया, एंड एज अ मेंबर ऑफ दैट पार्टी आई हैव पावर to influence others' behavior. So here is the fourth way by which we express or which we feel powerful. Next need that I will discuss is need for achievement. Need for achievement means when we want to achieve something, we want to reach in a particular level, that is called need for achievement. So our family, our parents, our role models, our cultural factors, they influence our need for achievement. Like I want to achieve something, I want to do something, so we many times we follow our parents. Like मैं अपनी मम्मी के जैसे पापा के जैसा कुछ करना चाहती हूँ, कुछ अचीव करना चाहती हूँ. हम लोग कोई रोल मॉडल्स होता है उसके जैसा मैं कुछ करना चाहती हूँ. कल्चरल फैक्टर का भी बहुत इफेक्ट है अचीवमेंट में. जिस कल्चर में जहाँ अचीवमेंट को ज़्यादा इम्पोर्टेंस देता है, वहाँ पीपल वहाँ का जो जनता है वो लोग अचीवमेंट को, मोस्ट ऑफ द पीपल फ्रॉम दैट कल्चर दे हैव हाई नीड फॉर अचीवमेंट. पीपल हु हैव हाई नीड फॉर अचीवमेंट जनरली दे सेट टारगेट्स विच आर ऑफ मॉडरेटली डिफिकल्ट एंड विच आर मॉडरेटली चैलेंजिंग. वाई? बिकॉज इफ द टास्क इज टू डिफिकल्ट, दैट विल बी डिफिकल्ट, दैट विल बी द पर्सन विल नॉट बी एबल टू रीच द गोल, सो दैट विल नॉट फुलफिल हिज नीड फॉर अचीवमेंट. और इफ द टास्क इज टू इजी, अगेन दैट विल नॉट फुलफिल द पर्सन्स नीड फॉर अचीवमेंट. सो हियर पीपल सेट अ गोल विच इज ऑफ मॉडरेट डिफिकल्टी. Also, people with high need for achievement prefer feedback from other people on their performance. Now, we'll discuss the two more motives, that are curiosity and exploration. Curiosity means when we want to know different things, new things, and we gain pleasure by obtaining information about different things. So, we are curious, that's why we explore the environment. So, एक researcher वो curious है कि क्यों कैसा होता है, कैसे होता है, क्या क्या प्रोसीड्यूर, इसलिए वो रिसर्च करता है टू नो द थिंग. बच्चे लोग जो वो लोग बहुत क्यूरियस होते हैं, उन लोग के इन्वायरमेंट के डिफरेंट थिंग को जानना है, देखना है, इसलिए वो लोग इन्वायरमेंट को एक्सप्लोर करते हैं, एक्सप्लोर करके देखते हैं। जैसे कि उसको नहीं पता कैसे हम लोग पेंट को यूज करते हैं, तो वो बहुत क्यूरियस है, वो पेंट को डिफरेंट तरह से यूज करके देखते हैं, वॉल में लिख के, पेज में लिख के, पेन को ऐसे पेन से किसी चीज में छेद करके, पेन को खोल के उसके अंदर क्या है देख के। सो पीपल आर चिल्ड्रन, दे आर क्यूरियस, सो दे वॉन्ट टू एक्सप्लोर देयर एनवायरमेंट इन डिफरेंट वे। सो क्यूरोसिटी इज अ मोटिवेशन विच गाइड अवर बिहेवियर, एंड बिकॉज ऑफ क्यूरोसिटी वी एक्सप्लोर द एनवायरमेंट टू नो द एनवायरमेंट बेटर।